Originally discovered in samples taken from Imperial Valley lettuce crops in the winter of 1992, the coronavirus known as lettuce chlorosis virus has a wide host range and is transmitted by the silverleaf whitefly Bemisia tabaci. During the process of its first documentation, it was assumed to be an indistinguishably similar and then recently documented virus, lettuce infectious yellows virus, which was associated with Bemisia tabaci, yellowing symptoms, and first described in Southern California and Arizona deserts a decade before in 1981. It became clear that lettuce chlorosis virus was unique, and in the decades that have followed, an understanding of its epidemiology, persistence in the environment, and host range has been assessed, though not one of the most pestiferous of the coronaviruses, its large host range and prolific insect vector should not be underestimated as climatic changes, new hosts, and evolutionary pressures, as well as additional vectors, may increase the global dispersal and virulence of the lettuce chlorosis virus. Indeed, as early as 2017, lettuce chlorosis virus has infected cannabis plants in the authorized farms of Israel, and has been confirmed as of August 2019. The crina in crinavirus refers to the Latin word for hair, or the tail of a comet, owing to the crinavirus's structure. The most prominent symptom of lettuce chlorosis virus is also its least unique, a lack of chlorophyll intravenally, causing yellowing, brittleness, and thickening of leaves in many hosts, severely and irrevocably reducing photosynthesis, which generally stunts growth, ultimately lethal for the individual plant. Vexingly, the silverleaf whitefly Bemisia tabaci causes acute chlorosis and stunting during feeding devoid of the presence of lettuce chlorosis virus inside themselves, making the combination of both particularly difficult for host plant development, reducing not only vegetative growth, but also that of resulting produce, and complicates early detection, since even the actual symptoms of the virus can be mistaken for nutritive, phototoxic, and chemical damage. Additionally frustrating is the rapid nature of lettuce chlorosis virus transmission, which can occur in less than a single hour of feeding by Bemisia tabaci, and even in plants treated with particularly insecticidal compounds like the neonicotinoid imidacloprid. And this suggests that even the more potent broad-spectrum compounds are not effective at limiting transmission in some cases, making them even less desirable for prevention when considering their economic costs, negative effects on biocontrol agents, local ecology, as well as the cost of target produce. Symptoms do not always present immediately, and can occur after 3 to 4 weeks, apparent in older leaves and unapparent in new leaves. Since the mid-1990s, coronaviruses in general have represented a major agricultural threat, specifically due to the whitefly vectors in the genera Trialorhodes and Bemisia, and represent agricultural losses of multiple billions of dollars annually. The first ever to be documented being the beet pseudo-yellows virus in 1960. Coronaviruses have a special characteristic in that they interact with other viruses during infection in ways that alter disease symptoms and severity, but singularly would be asymptomatic. And between different coronaviruses, co-infection can be competitive, and this dynamic may be exploitable in the future. Like other coronaviruses, lettuce chlorosis virus is currently not curable, and prevention of it relies on the prevention of their whitefly vectors, as well as host populations of non-crop plants that exist in the local or greater cultivation space. Culling plants susceptible to lettuce chlorosis virus or suitable for its vector inside and outside of the local cultivation space harshly reduces the capacity for both the agent and the vector to establish nearby. Bemisia tabaci was first described on Greek tobacco crops in 1889, and according to the European and Mediterranean Plant Protection Organization, is thought to have originated from India, having many recorded parasitoids native to the area. In the USA, it was documented first on sweet potato in 1897, Brazil on Euphorbia hirtella in 1928, and Taiwan on hibiscus in 1933, and it is now present globally. Populations of Bemisia tabaci in the Imperial Valley located in California, United States, increased by a factor of 300 from the mid-1970s to the mid-1980s, ultimately reaching a factor of 1600 in the mid-1990s. Bemisia tabaci became more seriously problematic in agriculture, particularly greenhouse floricultural and vegetable production, in the 1980s, around the same time that Legionella sclerosis virus and other crinoviruses were becoming documented. Bemisia tabaci has a host range of over 900 plant species according to the Invasive Species Database, and many overlap with Legionella sclerosis virus hosts, some of which are not crop plants but commonly established in cultivation spaces, and can host both the vector and the virus. With a prolific host range and proclivity for adaptation, global movement of living plant tissue has additionally facilitated the expansion and colonization of the silverleaf whitefly, as well as other closely related species. Bemisia tabaci produces honeydew, much like other Hemiptera, and this sugary waste excretion attracts ants and is a substrate for sooty molds in the family Capnodiales, which, while not directly pathogenic to the plants on which the honeydew resides, physically blocks light from reaching chlorophyll, or what little would still remain post-infection of Legionella sclerosis virus. In the end, one of the most useful prophylactic measures is the implementation and development of genetic resistance of the plant, first to the silverleaf whitefly and then to Legionella sclerosis virus. Genetic resistance is conferred through a complex and dynamic physiological interaction between the host plant, pest, and vectors associated with the pest. Susceptible plants that are able to kill whiteflies on contact with, for example, type 4 glandular trichomes, like those that produce various defense compounds like acyl sugars and terpenes, can severely disrupt the colonization of many pests of the phylosphere, and so reduce the onset of foliar feeding, eliminating the chance for transmission altogether. Similar resistance traits can be improved and selected for in order to better attenuate whitefly colonization. Integrating pathogens, parasites, and predators, both local and exotic to the cultivation space, can also help reduce whitefly populations. Commercially available biocontrol agents like parasitoid wasps in the genus Eretmoceras and Encarsia are commonly used, as are the predatory lady beetles Delphastis catilinae. Type 3b predatory mite Amblyseus swirskii and type 3e predatory mite Neocilius cucumeris are also used. Entomopathogenic fungi like Buveria bassiana are also highly effective at colonizing dense populations of whiteflies as well. Pyrethrins and azadirachtin are botanically derived chemicals that disrupt whitefly physiology. But resistance management techniques must be observed to suppress selection pressure for adaptation in silverleaf white flies, some populations of which being already well known for chemical resistance. The proactive integration of multiple techniques, biological, chemical, and cultural, will neutralize infesting and ambient populations in the cultivation space.